Good evening, everybody, and thank you for attending tonight's talk to commemorate the 80th anniversary of the Plymouth Blitz. My name is Elliot Clark, and for tonight's talk, I'm going to be talking about the morale which was brought to the city when the Prime Minister, Winston Churchill, and his wife, Clementine Churchill, visited the city in 1941 in the aftermath of the Plymouth Blitz. In this, we see the morale boosted of the city, but we also see the Churchills inspecting the damage which was inflicted by the Luftwaffe bombing raids. To begin this talk, I think it's really important to look at that relationship between Winston and Clementine Churchill to understand why they had the capabilities to boost the nation's morale during its darkest days. What we see here is that from the offset of their marriage in 1908, it became clear that this couple would become one of the most significant of the 20th century. They shared what I would call a joint desire to facilitate Churchill's aim and destiny of becoming Prime Minister. However, it also became clear that the political world would indulge both of them, and this caused great concern for Churchill. He wrote to Clementine during these very early years of their marriage that, "I often feel I must be a dull companion to anyone who is not in the trade." However, for Clementine, she relished in this opportunity her marriage to Churchill gave her. She may have felt she could not be a politician herself, but in her marriage to Churchill, she was able to play just a pivotal role, and this was highlighted during the Second World War. However, from their marriage in 1908 to Churchill becoming Prime Minister in 1940, Clementine had influenced, facilitated, and protected her husband's career. From engineering lunches with ministers during the First World War to show her husband's courage on the front line, to defending him fiercely at party conferences, Clementine had illustrated the political world, her power and influence over her husband's career. When Churchill was appointed Prime Minister in 1940, both Churchill and Clementine became a vital source to the nation's morale. And when on tour, it was Clementine, just as much as Churchill, the public looked for within the crowds. During this period, we see General Ismay state that the public regarded Clementine as an angel of mercy who possessed a great calming effect on others. And this is the first time in British history we have seen a politician's wife play such a significant role in bringing morale and passion to a nation in its darkest days. With Churchill now finding himself as Prime Minister and the nation under attack, Churchill had to utilise his skills as an orator to create a new sense of hope and courage for the British public during the nation's darkest days. The speeches heard during this time are ones we still recognise and hear today. Now, it's well known that Churchill was a great writer, but what we hear in these speeches is Churchill recognising the dangers, but more importantly, the values which were at risk. He recognised this partly as a result of his time in the trenches during the First World War. He knew the dangers involved, but more importantly, he believed he knew how to prevent them. And this is what we hear in these speeches. As well as understanding the dangers, Churchill was willing to put himself in a position of danger. Now we see this throughout his life, most significantly during the First World War, but now Prime Minister, the risk is even greater. Churchill would walk through the streets of London to inspect the damage which had been inflicted on the city. This caused great anxiety for many ministers, but they tried to prevent this, but to no prevail. It was soon recognised that only one person had the influence to protect Churchill from the danger and himself, that being Clementine. When Clementine found out what was happening, she joined him into the streets, and as General Ismay recalled, this time, concerned for her safety, he returned before nightfall. As we see by the report by the Daily Telegraph on screen now, Clementine was very often by her husband's side, and this is seen throughout the press. It was this understanding of danger and the values at risk which allowed Churchill to connect with the British public as he understood the mind and the mood of the nation. And this was most significant while on tour. Throughout the Blitz, Churchill remained in his belief that it was vital for him to inspect the damaged streets while on tour. In September 1940, after the London East End had experienced heavy raids, Churchill, along with General Ismay, examined the damaged streets for themselves, with many homes turned to rubble and the skeletons of other buildings still burning. Ismay recalled that one woman in the crowd shouted, "Good old Winnie, we knew you'd come and see us. We can take it, give it, then back." It's here we see what the media refers to as the Blitz spirit, that British tradition to keep calm and carry on. However, the reality of this situation was that it was more of a necessity to carry on, with little other option. Losing everything they possessed, they found no other choice but to fight on and unite with their neighbours to save what they could. Across London, we see people take shelter in the underground and pulling their belongings from the rubble where their homes once stood. Churchill realised he had to maintain positivity when the darkness felt so overpowering. It's this determination that brought the nation together in its darkest days, and it's this willingness to fight on which would prove vital in the years ahead. Now in late April 1941, Plymouth had experienced five severe nights of heavy bombing, with people across the city losing their homes and businesses. On May 2nd, Winston and Clementine Churchill arrived in the city to inspect the damage inflicted for themselves. Now, while on tour, the Churchills were accompanied by Lady Nancy Astor, MP for Plymouth Sutton Division, as well as being accompanied by President Roosevelt's special envoy, Averell Harriman. Now, Churchill and Lady Astor famously never agreed on matters, both politically and personally, but they toured the city side by side. And it was at this point Lady Astor won Churchill's admiration for her courage and constant care for the people of Plymouth during its hour of need. As an independent observer wrote, Churchill was found fierce-faced, firmly balanced on the back of the car, with great tears of sorrow in his eyes. Now, this is significant, as Churchill was often found with a tear in his eye while on tour, as he saw the emotion and heartbreak of those who had been affected by bombing. However, on this occasion, Lady Nancy Astor, as a response to Churchill in tears, said, "It's all very well to cry, Winston. You've got to do something about it." Churchill here realised the real heavy burden on his shoulders. After seeing the destruction in Plymouth, Churchill, more than anyone, realised that something had to be done. A Home Intelligence report put it bluntly that for the present, Plymouth, as a business and commercial centre of a prosperous countryside, has ceased to exist. The devastation of five nights of bombing had left Plymouth at a point of little repair. Churchill was shook by the sights he saw, and it eclipsed anything he had seen previously while on tour across the nation. On several occasions during the night of the tour, Churchill claimed, "I have never seen the like." Churchill remained frustrated that the Germans had managed to attack the city on five of the nine nights with limited defence from the RAF. In a note to Air Chief Marshal Charles Portal, Churchill asked why the RAF squadron charged with deploying aerial mines did not yet have its full completion of 18 aircrafts. Long after the tour of Plymouth, Churchill remained shaken from what he saw. However, he knew, while on tour, morale was key. The sorrow which these trips brought to Churchill only furthered his ambition for victory. But as we know, these trips were in place to boost morale of Plymouth. When walking through the dockyards, Churchill was cheered by workers, with others lining the streets to get a glimpse of the Prime Minister and his wife. Being able to meet the Prime Minister was a great boost for many across the city who had lost their homes and possessions. In a further attempt to boost the spirits of Plymouth, Churchill proclaimed to the crowds, "God bless you all. Your homes are down, but your hearts are high." The Churchill's visit to Plymouth was keenly observed by the press, with the War Office's official photographer, Captain Horton, following the Churchills across the city. But we also see coverage of the Plymouth tour on British Parfait. In one report, the presenter comments, "Here we can see Plymouth refuses to be beaten." And this was the spirit Churchill was trying to infuse across the nation. As acknowledged by Churchill's daughter, Mary Soames, Churchill had become the nation's symbol of hope and courage. And this is certainly apparent when in Plymouth. Despite these reports stating that morale was high, the opinion in Germany was quite different. In German reports, we see that the air raids on Plymouth had caused what the Germans described as outright panic for both the British public and British government. The German Minister of Propaganda wrote in his diary that the effect was devastating Britain, and the secret reports from London tell of a collapse of morale, principally caused by the German air raids. However, from Britain, the spirits of Plymouth were still high on the Prime Minister's tour. Churchill himself was shocked with the high spirits when so much devastation had swept the city. The German Minister of Propaganda further writes in his diary that Churchill was in a very depressed state. Although Churchill was shocked and devastated by the attacks, he had not lost his fighting spirit. Although these tours could do little structurally to rebuild Plymouth, it was the morale of the city which was important to uphold to get the nation through the war. Images of the crowds in Plymouth who came out to meet the Prime Minister would have been shown in the press across the country and would have been important to upholding not only the morale of Plymouth, but the whole nation. But in analysing this tour, it's interesting to question the other motivations behind it. As already discussed, Churchill took a personal interest in inspecting the damaged streets to examine the damage inflicted by German attacks. But what importance could this trip have in gaining American support? As mentioned, in Plymouth, Churchill was accompanied by Avril Harriman, who would be reporting back to the president information from these tours. With Plymouth having a strong connection to America already, with the setting of the Mayflower and Pilgrim Fathers in 1620, reporting the damage and the attacks Plymouth was facing could have been an attempt to pull on the heartstrings of the president. This could be further supported by Nancy Astor's heritage in Virginia. Although this is partly speculation, as we'll never know the motivations behind these tours or the mind of Britain's Prime Minister, what we do know is Churchill eagerly wanted American support, and this could have been a key way to achieve it. It's clear that Churchill needed to boost not only the morale of the people to continue the war, but required American support. As Churchill himself said, "Give us the tools and we'll finish the job." It was not just Churchill these tours mattered to. It allowed Clementine to also understand the mood of the nation. As well as supporting her husband's work, Clementine indulged herself into her own war work. In 1941, Clementine was made the chair of the Aid to Russia Fund, which raised money to send to Russia to provide medical supplies and also clothing. With the support of public appeals, in its first 12 days of operation, the fund raised £370,000, and in December that year, it exceeded its initial target of £1 million. For her work with the fund, Clementine was invited on tour in Russia, where she was met by the adoring Russian public. While on tour, Clementine saw the devastation which had hit Russia. She saw the fund had to do more, and she continued her work for the years ahead. But Churchill also recognised that Clementine's work in Russia was an opportunity to improve alliances between the two nations. Churchill requested that Clementine expressed his desire to Stalin for a continued friendship. During this period, Churchill described Clementine as the one bright star in Anglo-Russian relations. Clementine's war work put her even more so in the public eye, and she became adored by the media for her connection she made with the public. She became what I'd argue as the mother of a nation. And it's this same charm and commitment to the people that Clementine once again shows in Plymouth and puts her once again in the eye of the media. While on tour in 1941, an observer in Plymouth wrote that there was much pleased feminine comment on Mrs. Churchill's striking appearance. Snow leopard coat with flaunt sleeves, a handkerchief over her head, with phrases of her husband's speeches printed on them. Clementine's fashion was regularly commented on by the media, and this was an image partly constructed by the press, but was also one utilised as a weapon by Number 10 to provide the public with glamour, as Clementine's stylish outfits created an image of a brighter future for the public who attached themselves to any glimmer of hope. On these tours, Clementine once again illustrated that the nation's interests came before her own. She was deeply impacted by these tours and realised the long road ahead of the nation, and realised it would never be an easy one. After a visit to one city, Clementine broke down and exclaimed, "Pray God we don't let them down." It's this quote from Clementine which I really think highlights the importance of these tours. For the Churchills, they caused deep emotion as they recognised the responsibility that lay on their shoulders. Clementine felt this pressure just like her husband, and these tours illustrated the important role Churchill held in leading the war effort, not only in the front line, but in maintaining morale at home. The Blitz tours to city like Plymouth allowed Churchill to connect with the people and understand their mood. He connected with them so well as he held similar concerns. Many had experienced sons, fathers, and husbands going to war and never to return. This was a real fear for Churchill also. When war broke out and his only son Randolph asked to play a part in the war effort, Churchill's private secretary, John Colville, recalled how Churchill told him that if Randolph were killed, he would not be able to carry on his work. This was a fear felt across the nation throughout the war. The emotions Churchill expressed in Plymouth were very real, as he recognised the long road ahead and the sacrifices the whole nation would make. The devastation that Churchill witnessed while in Plymouth remains with him for much of his life. The Home Intelligence Report, which states that Plymouth ceased to exist, truly highlights the level of destruction across the city. We see the Churchill's tour of Plymouth even recorded in the Churchill Family Album, produced by Churchill's daughter, Mary Soames. This even more so highlighting the scale and the impact Plymouth had on Churchill throughout his life. Churchill had experienced warfare before, during the First World War, when serving as First Lord of the Admiralty, as well as serving on the front line. But while Prime Minister during the Second World War, nothing could prepare him for this moment. Plymouth had highlighted this new era of warfare and highlighted to Churchill even more so now that Britain needed the support of the United States. Similarly, to fight on through the war, the morale of the nation was crucial and had to be kept high. To claim victory, it had to be a national effort. Through his speeches and through his Blitz tours, Churchill was able to reassure the nation and uphold that British spirit. As Churchill proclaimed in his first speech as Prime Minister, "Let us go forward together with our united strength." Churchill's tour of Plymouth in 1941 was just one of many he made across the nation. And as previously mentioned, while in Plymouth, Churchill proclaimed to the crowds, "Your homes are down, but your hearts are high." It is these comments which motivate the nation to go on. As an orator, Churchill's speeches are the most memorable from the House of Commons from throughout British history. Historians have argued that no politician could have motivated and mobilised a nation like Churchill did during the Second World War. But on these Blitz tours, what we see, it is not only about motivating the public, but it is providing Churchill with the spirit and determination he needed to fight on. With this paper, I hope I've been able to show how significant these Blitz tours were to both Winston and Clementine Churchill, as well as the British public. I want to thank you all very much for listening to this paper, and I hope I can answer any questions you may have in the Q&A section later. If not, I'm happy to answer those questions via Twitter or via email. I'd like to finish this paper with a quote from Clementine to Jock Colville while on the train back to London from Plymouth in 1941. Clementine to Jock said, "Do you think we're going to win?" Jock simply and softly said, "Yes." Thank you very much for listening.
Terrific. Thank you very much, Elliot. Now, we've had some questions sent in for you to answer, so it's yours, Bell, in the hot seat. And obviously, these questions have been sent in advance and during, so apologies if you've already slightly addressed the odd bit of them. And the first one, of course, is where does this idea to visit, to do the Blitz tours originate? Can you talk more about this impetus? Presumably, it's not as easy as just waking up one morning, seeing there's been an air raid and getting that whole show on the road.
Yeah, you've definitely got a case there that for Churchill in particular, when you're going on these Blitz tours, you can't just simply go, this takes minister's work and weeks to sort of prepare for this sort of event to go ahead. For Churchill in particular, it's normally Jock Colville, which is planning these events. I think I mentioned in the talk there that Jock played a really key part behind this. But it's not just Plymouth that Churchill visits. We see that he's visiting Portsmouth in 1941 as well. So when he's going on these tours, it's not simply one city. It is a whole tour going through the country to evaluate the damage going through. And this is really important for Churchill on these tours. He's able to evaluate the damage, but more importantly, understand the mood of the nation. And that's what's really key for Churchill on these tours.
Great, thank you. So, I mean, again, given your research and given some of what you've talked about, I know you've already touched on some of this, but can you expand on how important and how central to the mission, I guess, why it was important for Mrs. Churchill to come along, for Clementine to come along?
Yeah, so obviously a lot of my research is based on Clementine, and there's two reasons behind this. The first reason is Clementine took that really significant role that she also wanted to understand the mood of the nation as well. And she was really good at doing this because she had that experience from the First World War where she was going to the munition canteens. And in the Second World War, we have her with the Aid to Russia Fund. She's able to connect with the people of Plymouth in a personal manner. She connects with them because they have families. She has the family at home, and they've been able to connect in that way. But more importantly behind this, that it's looking at Churchill's health and protecting him as well. Clementine decided in those really early years of the war that Churchill would never travel alone. If it wasn't Clementine on tour with Churchill, it would be one of the daughters. And most famously from that, we see that Sarah Churchill accompanies Winston to the Yalta Conference in 1945. So it's really two parts to that question. You've got the protection of Churchill, but you've also got Clementine's really eager to evaluate this for her own war work as well.
Thank you. And so speaking about Clementine's sort of First World War visits and connections, does Churchill himself have connections to Plymouth, given the Royal Navy connections he's built up over the previous sort of generation?
Yeah, Churchill served as First Lord of the Admiralty twice before this point in 1941 when he's Prime Minister. He obviously has a real key eye on what's happening within the Admiralty, and Plymouth is a key naval dockyard similar to Portsmouth on the other tour he did. He would be keeping a really key eye on this, and he attended the dockyard several times, not only in this trip in 1941, but later on during the war. And not only as a naval town, but as a city itself, Plymouth was quite important for the Churchill family altogether. We see Randolph Churchill campaigning to be MP for Devonport later on, and Churchill himself comes down to support his son's campaign. So as a naval city and as a city itself, Plymouth is quite important, and we see Churchill appear within the city on a number of occasions.
That's great. Thanks very much. So.